From the studio at the Connecticut School of Broadcasting in Charlotte, this is Adrian Brown with As the Buckle Turns, Episode 4. I'd like to thank you all again if you've tuned in for my previous episodes. As usual, it does me good to see, the numbers go up or down, fluctuating. It doesn't really matter as long as maybe I'm saying something you guys want to hear. Maybe, like I said, you've been listening to it from a share or anything like that. Either way, I appreciate it all. The Raw review didn't get quite as many views as I got in the first couple, but I mean, really, what can you expect when these shows aren't really giving you much to talk about? So therefore, I didn't have much to talk about, and I didn't really give you guys much to listen to or react to. But that can be expected these times when, if you're watching it, you see what you're getting in. And if you're not watching it, if you heard me talk about it, you pretty much know there really wasn't much to talk about. But I'm going to go into some things I may have saw the last time, but I didn't really want to get into it too much because it had already ran on too long as it was. First thing I want to get into, well, just to let you know, I don't just watch the WWE product. I like to, give a nod to, a couple of Canadians who just won Japanese titles in NJPW. Kenny Omega and Jericho won their respective matches for their respective titles in those matches. So we've got Jericho as your new IWGP Intercontinental Champ. Congrats, Chris. You're one of the best performers of all time, bar none. You should probably just walk into the Hall of Fame in any organization. Lifetime achievement, whatever. You're just one of the greatest of all time. And of course, Kenny Omega, who a lot of people think is probably going to be the guy to carry this business the next few years. The jury's probably still out on that for me. Congrats to him. He won the IWGP title, which has been held by some pretty big names in its history. So congrats to him on that as well. And of course, these two guys were beating the crap out of each other a few months ago. And now they're backstage taking pictures with each other with their titles on their shoulders. I mean, again, protect your business, folks. Again, everybody wants to be buddy-buddy and show that they're buddy-buddy. This is where things fail a lot of times. Like I said, you're supposed to make the people believe that what they're seeing is real, even though they know it's not. Protect your business, people. No more photo ops in the back. None of this taking pictures with the talent relations guy, putting himself over. Enough already, man. Just please make me believe again. Make me believe that you actually care about me watching you. Make me believe that you actually believe in what you're doing. Protect your business. Protect us from ourselves at times, please. And that's just another little problem I have with stuff like that. But anyway, on to something I had brought up on Twitter a few days ago regarding Seth Rollins. Like I said in the last podcast during the Raw review, Seth Rollins is an excellent worker. I mean, the guy's absolutely incredible. He can go in the ring, whatever. My main concern with that guy will always be that annoying voice of his. You'll never hear me say, the guy, quote, can't wrestle, because, as a guy who's never stepped in the ring, what do I know what good wrestling actually is? I mean, like I said, he's going to tear the house down every single time he's out there. But what he's done, like I said, what they're doing with him is they've pimped out the Intercontinental Championship into open challenges. This all started when Cena won the U.S. title from Rusev at WrestleMania. And here's where I did not have a problem with Cena doing that. Cena is a star. Cena's an all-time great. Wrestling Cena, whether you win or lose, still is a benefit to both guys. See, if you have a competitive match with John Cena, television, pay-per-view, it doesn't matter. Eyeballs are going to be on it because eyeballs are always on John Cena. You get what I'm saying? So you get the rub from John Cena either way, whether he squashes you, get it? Or if you have a competitive 15-minute match with the guy. You know, it's the same thing compared to what he did for The Undertaker at this past WrestleMania. You know, wrestling The Undertaker at WrestleMania instantly gives you some semblance of credibility. And Cena doing those open challenges for the U.S. title every week after he had won the title, it kind of served the exact same purpose. You feel me? So I have no issue with a guy at that level being able to do something like that. My issue with Seth Rollins doing this, especially with the IC title, who benefits from a competitive match with Seth Rollins? Who? I mean, the answer to that is absolutely clear. The person who benefits the most, Seth Rollins. No one else. See, Seth is always going to get his stuff in because when he's put in that spot for a reason. And when he's tearing the house down with his blockbusters and sling blades and his suicide dives, automatically the crowd's popping for all that stuff. So it doesn't matter what you do. They're obviously going to be, because he's one of their darlings, that this era of fans, he's one of their darlings. So he's always going to benefit from any type of open challenge because most of the time the guy that's holding the belt is going to go over. So all he's got to go out there and do is just be himself. He's like, I only know one speed. I only know one gear. I'm going to make this happen. I'm going to get my stuff in, probably do a curb stomp out of nowhere. Crowd's going to pop. I'm going to swing the belt. Boom. I'm still good. Okay. Seth beats, Apollo Crews in that match. What does that do for Apollo Crews? Because all anybody's talking about after the match is over is Seth Rollins. Most of the time in all of his matches, that's all they're talking about is what he did. You still probably don't even remember who won who he was wrestling. And that shouldn't be the issue. When Cena was doing his open challenge, you can recall who he wrestled, how the match went for both guys, and what it did for said wrestler that he, even though he won most of the time, every time during his open challenge for the U.S. title, it made a difference for the guy he was wrestling because so many eyeballs are always on him that as the guy that's stepping up to him, you're going to step your game up because that's probably going to be the most watched segment of the show. You get it? So you got to bring it. Are you really going to bring your total 100% A game if you're wrestling Seth Rollins if all he's going to do is get his stuff in regardless? Because what's going to happen. You got to stand there. You got to let him hit his moves. He's got to turn it up to 100 and go crazy and get the crowd on his side constantly, which they probably already are anyway. So, who benefits? Seth and Seth only. And you can do that with the U.S. title because in the end, we know what Vince thinks of WCW and what he always thought of them. And that's a WCW title. And the Intercontinental title, like I said, was always supposed to be 1B. It was always supposed to be elevated. Now, to me, like I said, because Brock is not there, they're trying to use that as the selling point to watch the show, and it's really not working. It's just another belt on the show. I really wish they would just somehow would have elevated that 205, that cruiserweight division, somehow to make it important. But I think that cruiserweight, that challenge, I think it hurt it more than anything when they brought in those other guys who were only going to be there for the tournament, who didn't really have any staying power after the fact, and they had to put it on T.J. Perkins, the guy isn't terrible, but let's be honest, he doesn't really move the needle. And the most prestige that division has gotten was from a guy who's no longer with the company over false accusations now, it seems. Enzo had that title, and three times? The cruiserweight division closed the show. And that elevated that division more than anything. Why? Because the guy's an actual character. you know, and he gave the guys who he chose to be with him, he gave them the nod as well. That's what a star does. That's what character does for you. You know, this is where you need to bring back those other titles to give those guys on the quote lower card something to fight for. Okay? And you have to, like I said, pimp out the IC title in these matches on a weekly basis, and it's really probably diminishing the value of it more than the Universal title not actually being on Raw. I mean, at least Brock, when Brock finally shows up, it's going to mean something. But Seth coming out there week after week is really not doing much for it. And I'm not really sure if it will. On to something else. All right, there's a contingent of people who like to believe that NXT is this end-all, be-all for the entire business, or especially for the company of WWE. They even think it's completely separate from Raw and SmackDown when it's not. The main reason most people probably like it, they probably won't admit it, is because it's hour-long. Okay, it is pre-taped. And yes, I agree. There are no storylines in NXT. There are rivalries, yes. And they manufacture these rivalries on a week-by-week basis within that hour time frame to make you believe in something. And honestly, they do that fairly well. But in the end, most traditionalists like myself, they can't really take that show too well. Because, like I said, the crowd sends you off. It kind of set something off in me a lot of times, the more I kept watching it. And that's why I haven't watched it in almost a year now, it seems. Probably, I think the last time I really cared is when I heard about the rivalry between the Velveteen Dream and Aleister Black, and that match absolutely delivered. But other than that, I haven't really had much to get attached to, because once the Undisputed Era came in, I'm just like, oh great, here we go again, same old same. But the reason I'm bringing that up again, this is where I hashtag IWC logic. Hypocrisy of a mindset. Most of you probably remember a wrestler by the name of Eva Marie, who, what was it, won the Diva Search or something like that. The girl had no wrestling experience. She was just trying to get into the business and learn. Okay. Immediately, the people always were chanting, "You can't wrestle." Of course, she couldn't wrestle. She hadn't learned yet. And then when she tried to put her back into it and actually try and learn it, they still wouldn't give her a chance. Simply because she had won a contest. They won't admit it. That's the main reason why. Number two, probably most of those people booing are probably, the guys are probably just mad because they probably never scored a chick that looked like that. And the girls are probably mad because they never looked like that. Yeah, I said it. Come at me. I don't care. But from the last season of Tough Enough, the young lady who came in second, Mandy. Okay. She's now Mandy Rose. And I look at the two of them. These two women, outside of their hair color, are exactly the same. They move the same. They darn near look the same. I mean, one came out with all red in her entrance. The other comes now out now with gold in her entrance. I mean, look at them. The way they dress, their ring gear is pretty much exactly the same. And I'm looking at this, and I have to say to myself, I'm like, I hear all these people putting her over constantly. I was like, oh man, she's improving weekly. Oh, she just went toe-to-toe with Asuka and she looked great. And I'm watching her and all I'm seeing is Eva Marie. 100%. But then I had to think about it. I'm like, well, what's the difference here? Again, the only difference between the two of them is three letters. NXT. See, again, you will always get more credit from these people if you go through those three letters than if you were, quote, handed something, even though she was the runner up on another show for a WWE contract. You get what I'm saying? See, this is where that hypocrisy of a mindset comes in. And I look at the two of them, there really isn't much difference. A lot of people saying Mandy's like the second coming of Trish Stratus. I'm sorry, she's nowhere near that athletic. She's nowhere near that charismatic. She's nowhere near me. Trust me, you look at her, she's an attractive girl. She's blonde, that's it. The comparisons between her and Trish Stratus end there. I don't see her. She doesn't have Trish's speed. She doesn't have Trish's athleticism. She's probably stronger than Trish. That's no doubt. I mean, look at the girl's ripped. You see her. She's picking up these other girls. She's very strong. But other than that, I don't see it. She doesn't have Trish's natural presence. Mandy's is a little bit more manufactured. Trish didn't need any fancy lighting. All she had to do was just come out there pointing and skipping and smiling. And you're like, that's a star. Mandy's a little bit more produced. She's a little bit more contrived. And I just don't see it. They only see it because of NXT. Because she went through the process. Think about that. On to the main reason I wanted to record this show. A lot of times, I get a lot of my thoughts off of social media from things that I see. Like, one of the main things I was talking about last week was, again, from Twitter, from a YouTube personality. So this week, I was struggling to figure out what I want to talk about. And I was wondering if I was going to be able to record anything. And then I came across this tweet from TNA/Impact independent wrestling great Austin Aries. Now, somebody put up a tweet, and it was a GIF of his post-match sitting on the floor after he had lost to Neville at Extreme Rules. I can't remember what it was. TLC something. I can't remember. And he's just there smiling. So he quotes the tweet and says something to the effect of, and I'm sorry I don't have it in front of me right now. Probably should have prepared better, but whatever. The one thing he says, something along the lines of, didn't have the freedom, and to my opponent in the image, we can do it again, this time with the shackles off, or something like that. What a difference a year makes. I'll probably link it to you in the description of this podcast, but you'll be able to see it for yourself. And then somebody else said, replied to it and said something to the effect of, I can tell you who the WWE Cruiserweight champ is, who knows who the Impact champ is and things like that. Plus you're probably making more money. And Austin's like, I guess your definition of happiness is different from mine. Okay, listen, the main thing that got me was the shackles comment. Shackles. And it just bothers me a little bit sometimes, especially when these guys leave the company. And you'll see a lot of times these independent promotions anyway, they'll put that, say if it's somebody like a Jack Swagger or something like that, they will put on the flyer, directly on the flyer, former WWE talent. And they will allow these companies to use that old branding, their old stomping grounds, to promote their business. And it's not like the former talent is not letting them do it. And the main thing I wanted to get into was this. The WWE, you're doing over 300 plus shows a year, and you've got ample opportunity. You've got ample time to put yourself out there. You're on television or you're on the network. You've got all these opportunities to brand yourself and make something of yourself. Okay. How are you better off for yourself out there in obscurity, having to work for six different companies, doing all that traveling? You probably are making more money gross by going to all these other companies. Yes. But when you factor in travel, rental cars, plane tickets, especially if you're flying back and forth overseas and things like that. When you add up all your expenses, your management, maintaining your websites and things like that, to having to do all your promotion, really in general, how much are you really pocketing? I want you to really think about that, because The WWE automatically gives you this big, huge promotion machine that they're running themselves. So all you got to focus on is protecting your business as a character, keeping yourself in shape, eating right, making sure you make your flights, making sure a lot of that stuff. I know they pay the wrestlers pay for out of their own pocket, especially like insurance, because the WWE doesn't give you insurance, if I'm not mistaken. But this whole thing about shackles and holding you back. Okay. I'm not fond of these guys wanting to constantly go out there and slaughter themselves on a nightly basis, giving away pay-per-view quality matches every Monday and Tuesday night, instead of giving people those type of matches at pay-per-views. This is where white people say a lot of times, and they don't even understand this, that when they watch a quote pay-per-view or special event, whatever you want to call it, because we know pay-per-view is dead. This is where they don't understand this. The reason a lot of times you're saying that this pay-per-view was nothing but a glorified Raw is because they're giving you a lot of the stuff you've already seen on Raw, on SmackDown. Okay? You should, the whole time during those 4 weeks, even at, like, think of Raw as a bigger house show. Okay, I watch house show matches. I've gone to several WWE lives, and you can see how scaled back the production is of the set. So those guys know when they're getting out there, this isn't a big time thing. So even what they do a lot of times in those matches, they're having fun. You know, they're not doing near the amount of things that they normally would do on a Raw. So my whole thing is this. Think of Raw as simply just a step up from a house show, a WWE live event. Don't be giving us all these, you know, holy-ish moments. I mean, for a show that you should be saving for the big show. Okay, you got to protect yourself in that way. So, see, guys like Aries, guys like his opponent in that match, Neville. They want to go out there because they weren't taught the correct way. Because everybody's a wrestling trainer now. Everybody's a wrestling promoter now. These guys aren't telling you when they're being trained now. They're not trained in the right way in how to protect themselves, you know, how to you know be a star. But a lot of times they want to sit there. They want to tear the house down every single time. But sometimes you got to be able to get yourself over in just a few minutes. And it also depends on how the show is written. Okay. One of the things that always comes to mind is the Talking Smack segment, the now legendary Talking Smack segment with Daniel Bryan and The Miz, when Daniel Bryan flat out comes out and calls The Miz a coward because of the way he wrestled.
That's the kind of thing is that you, to me, there's no gentle way to say it. To me, you wrestle like a coward. You wrestle like somebody who's afraid to get hit.
Like, I wrestle like a coward.
You wrestle like a coward.
I'm the one.
If I were to create a wrestler who, to me, like embodies, like when I was an independent guy and I was thinking like, oh, okay, what's the soft WWE style? It would be that. WWE is transformed in the last.
And The Miz, of course, takes exception to that. You know, work, shoot, whatever you want to call it. Okay. That quote soft style that they would call it on, that they call on the indies, protects these guys year round. You see what I'm saying? See, I understand in order to get noticed when you're wrestling in those armories and those backyards and in those high school gyms or in that carnival parking lot or something like that, you have to do things to get yourself noticed. There's a reason you were doing those things, but these guys, they become so locked in to being able to do that, that once they get there, they forget their character. It goes right out the window a lot of times once they're on TV. They either that or they forgot to develop one in the first place. And that's a problem. And that's a problem I think that's going to pervade this business for a long time unless the training starts from scratch. What Paul Orndorff was doing with those guys down at the power plant, that was the correct thing. focus on physicality, make sure they look right. I mean, the one thing the Performance Center for NXT down in Florida is doing correctly is giving these guys promo classes. But at the same time, they're still just churning out a bunch of robots with great entrances. So, I mean, please. And I would tell Austin Aries, listen, Cody Rhodes, he even said himself that the whole thing about Vince holding talent back is fake. Because he said himself, he's like, you know, I didn't progress as Stardust because I got out of shape. I got comfortable. You see what I'm saying? Now, even a guy who's beloved right now since he's been out, who also said he's made more money since he's left the WWE, it's been his most profitable year. But this is another guy who's been working for multiple promotions, lots of travel, even to Japan, and things that he's going to be fronting the bill now for his own event. He's put his name on, his stamp on. So again, how much money are you really walking away with if you're working for multiple promotions doing all this traveling? If you're constantly working, I mean, this guy's already had stitches in his eye. He never had to have something like done in WWE. Speaking of eye, Austin Aries was injured a lot of times. In his short little run in WWE, he had an eye injury. Why? Because you don't know how to slow it down. You don't know how to be more careful about yourself and your business. Save me the shackles talk. Because those shackles are supposed to ensure that the company is able to get as much out of you as is possible. And I can recognize that Aries is a star in his own way. But when you sit there and you become a mark for yourself and a mark for a certain style of wrestling, as opposed to protecting yourself and opposed to protecting your opponents, that becomes a problem. And that problem's not going to disappear until we, you know, quote, burn this down and start from scratch. And it's all going to have to start with the training and the mindset. There I go with that word again, mindset. It's almost like there are more marks in the ring than there are in the crowd at times. It's just that these marks, egos, are bigger than the ones that are actually paying to see them. And that's the big problem. Think about it. You're allowed all that television time. You're allowed that promotional machine behind you. Even if your paycheck is a little bit bigger, you got to remember too, now you're able to negotiate for more money because you were in said promotion. And that promoter may not be able to pay the lower talent more because they're paying you more simply because you can claim three little letters, WWE. You won't think about it in that aspect, would you? Because they grant you other opportunities as well. Action figures, DVDs. If you develop your character and become a star, you'll be able to have your own movie or things like that. That's residual income. You don't think about that at times, sometimes, I'm guessing, either. It goes back down to what I say. Talent. True talent will always rise to the top. Yeah, I understand hard work is important. But hard work is expected. True talent will always be rewarded over anything else. Yes, that talent still must work hard. But if you're just naturally gifted, if you have it, trust me, you won't have to work nearly as hard. You won't have to be getting hit with light tubes and diving off ladders for change. Think about that. And to me, that would be more important than anything else. You're not being held back. You don't have shackles. It's always up to a company to protect its talent a lot of times from the talent themselves. Because a lot of times certain people are left to their own devices. I mean, they'll simply just go out there and hurt themselves for no reason. Not just hurt themselves, hurt others. And maybe not even just their opponent. Maybe some fans too, if they really want to take it too far. I don't want to see that. Because the WWE as a company is not infallible. The WWE as a company is not perfect. But protecting its own investments, protecting its assets, You'll never hear me complain about them doing such a thing. And sometimes, if you're not protected from yourself, you'll probably end up hurting yourself more than anything. And all that extra money you think you're getting from carrying around six belts to six different promotions, it's not going to mean anything in the end. But it'll look good in a GIF, on a JPEG, on Google search. But if that's what you want, if that's your height of stardom, that's where you want to be at, props to you, I guess. That's As the Buckle Turns this week. Leave me some suggestions about what you may be seeing online, or send me a tweet or something like that, and I'll get a chance to burn on it one day. Until then, this is Adrian Brown. I'll see you next time on As the Buckle Turns.